Now we are live, sir. Hi, students. Welcome to the webinar series of Careers 360. Today, I decided that, you know, we should talk about management education because quite a few questions have come to me off late, at the undergrad level, especially these days. Of course, postgrad, a lot of people do ask us about MBA and all. But this time around, I realized that there were, you know, as compared to last year, I think there were far too many questions on undergrad, you know, options at management education. And I was searching for people who would be able to respond back to these students. And the first person I thought is Dr. Rajan Saxena. He's the former vice chancellor of Narasimhanji Institute of Management Studies. You know, as you would know, NMIMS started off possibly as a management institute, and Dr. Saxena can possibly explain at some point in time. And then morphed into what it is today, which offers every kind of course under the sun in terms of education. So I thought that the first person I thought was Dr. Rajan Saxena. And then, you know, the other guest that we have, the other expert that we have is Dr. Atish Chattopadhyay. I remember I used to meet him when he was IMT. And then he moved on to IFM. And by the way, congratulations, Atish, because today you've been appointed, I'm told, as the Vice Chancellor of Vijay Bhumi University, the university that's about to be launching its courses this year at Karjat.
Thank you.
What we have are two experts who understand management education, have devoted their lives towards you know, management education for the last 30, 40, 50 years, if I may say so. So to that extent, I think that all of us will be very wise by the time we finish this Q&A, you know, counseling round, in terms of understanding what students must do and how, and hopefully, you know, the two experts will help you, guide you, and advise you of what you must do for your own career paths. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us.
Thank you.
Dr. Saxena, your opening comments of Narasimhanji and it being a management institution and morphing into what it is today under your leadership.
As you very rightly said while introducing me, NMIMS is today an institution that was established in 1981 as a management institute. And in a much shorter time period of just been about 15 years or so, it emerged as one of the top 10 B schools of this country. And since then, it has continued to be among the top 10 B schools of this country. And not only so, in 2003, based on the performance of the institution, NMIMS was given a deemed to be university status by the Government of India, which was later confirmed in 2007, it now made it a permanent status. From 2009 onwards, the transformation of NMIMS began, a multidisciplinary university. An important part of this kind of a transformation was that we wanted to get into various disciplines, not just merely remain a management school. While the management school will continue to drive the institution, we realized that to really become a great management school, we need to have multiple other disciplines because we can draw from other disciplines in the management education itself. And that was the reason why we started off with the engineering, the pharmaceutical sciences, or for that matter, in the area of biological sciences, architecture, hospitality, design, liberal arts, name them today. Today we have about 16 schools within the university fold, and roughly about 14 disciplines that we talk about. We realized also that a great opportunity came for us in the undergraduate education, particularly in the area of business itself. When I looked at the countrywide itself, the nationwide undergraduate education, I realized that somewhere or the other, we have missed understanding what this younger generation was really wanting. There were problems of quality in the public system, so the problem of employability after the graduation, which was there. The third one was that perhaps the programs have never been evaluated or they've been upgraded, and there have been no touch with the industry at all. And at the same time, there was a big kind of a concern, which was that was it really a value for money, even when the undergraduate education was priced low? So we decided to create an undergraduate education, which was more aligned to the industry, more aligned to the society. And therefore, from that kind of a point of view, the first kind of a program that really went through this kind of a transformation was the BBA program. When I took over in 2009 as the Vice Chancellor, our BBA strength was just about 120 or 180. And we realized that we have an opportunity there, as I just said. And so therefore, when I based my experience on my teaching in the US and Canada, so the BBA program really formed the base of a management education in that part of the world. And therefore, from that perspective, we started looking at what it is that we need to do. We created a program with the help of industry, and not only with the help of the industry, but we also looked at what were the societal needs. We invested heavily in terms of improving, in terms of quality. And we also said that when the student graduates from here, two things must happen. If the student wants to join the industry, he or she should be able to join the industry at the analyst level, or at the grass, or at the supervisory level, or at an executive level. Or B, if the student wants to study for an MBA program, then he should be a preferred candidate in the top B schools anywhere in the world, and not only so, but even in the Indian institution itself.
Thank you, Dr. Saxena.
So that is, I think, it has been.
Atish, from your perspective, because Vijay Bhumi is setting up now, and congratulations for being the Vice Chancellor from today onwards, I'm told. Exactly is the objective of Vijay Bhumi? What does it look for?
See, it is actually addressing a very crucial gap in the education space of India. The major gap is, I think, we need more universities which have connect to the industry. So, grooming professionals, that is number one. But what kind of professionals? The three important aspects that we are looking at is that allowing the students to actually discover what they are good at. So, our institution is multidisciplinary. We are, allowing the students to go through each of the areas where they may be good at, which is the eight, basic intelligences individuals have, which is like, language, mathematical intelligence, musical intelligence, intrapersonal, interpersonal, natural, what I call body kinesthetics. Now, what has happened all through is intelligence in India has been looked at as mathematical intelligence. We want to equate a Wordsworth and Einstein in the same way. So after somebody comes in, we would allow our students to discover what they are good at and then pursue what discipline they would like to go for. So the program is a very different way. So discovery is one of the key anchors in the university. And it's a liberal education combined with professional. So we are the first liberal professional university, if I have to say, in India.
Okay. Dr. Saxena, this is something Atish said, something which is very interesting. The CAT examination is largely skewed towards mathematics. In the sense that students who've done mathematics, there's a bias towards them, right? And now you actually have management education, B-schools who are saying that they're more than the art students are more than welcome. First of all, is management an arts or a science to begin with? And two, is management education for an art student to begin with?
Yeah, I think, let me put it across in the first place. I think for a long time, the mathematical part has been overplayed, as was said by Atish also. And CAT has been heavily biased towards it. Quantitative skills, itself, testing of the quantitative skills. Over a period of time, we did see industry also giving a lot of value to that, the quantitative skills. Until the time they realized that what we were getting were just the morons coming out from the schools. And therefore, from that kind of a point of view, we realized that there was a need to really bring about a change. And GMAT, for example, changed dramatically. And it did start including a lot of non-qualitative kind of sections itself, and giving them a greater degree of weightage itself. Now, the universities could possibly decide on the way that they're doing. Coming back to the question of management versus whether this is in science or in art, I believe it is both, if I were to say that. It's a science because there are certain kind of there are certain models, there are certain kind of concepts, there are certain principles which are embedded in a whole lot of an understanding of the of a phenomena, of the markets, and these are, as I said, are based in mathematics. These are based in some sciences. So, for example, if you're talking about operations management itself, operations research, well, you've got to have a good understanding of the linear programming, etc. But at the same time, when it comes to managing people, when it comes to, let's say, planning for an uncertain environment, then in that case, it's more a function of the art of decision making. Unfortunately, when you start looking at it only from one kind of a point of view, you run out of it. Today, I believe that there's a greater degree of weightages now coming up in management education in the area of emotional intelligence, for example, in the area of environmental part, social sensitivity, and certainly it is in terms of looking at, even in some of the cases, it is moving towards the spirituality, the spiritual management itself. And therefore, from that kind of a perspective today, we are talking about a much more holistic management, who's groomed in quantitatives or groomed in science of management and also knows how to do it. The how part of doing it is really the art.
But Atish, if a student were to come to you and tell you that, listen, I'm an art student, I've done languages and I want to do an MBA. And this is a common question that we keep getting, because the perception or the belief is still that, you know, management education is for people who understand mathematics. How would you respond to a fine arts student or a liberal arts student who wants to still do MBA?
I will quote first one academic and then one practitioner. So it was Peter Drucker who said, management is a liberal art. And, you know, Jack Welch said that it is about head, heart, and the gut. So it is the heart and gut which becomes very important. And Howard Gardner's, you know, multiple intelligence theory says there are 8 intelligences if you look at it. You know, they are linguistic, music, visual, spatial, intrapersonal, interpersonal, okay, nature, in the understanding nature. All these becomes crucial ones, and mathematical intelligence is only one. Now, today's situation, and sir just now talked about dealing with uncertainty. Now, if we look at it, that today we are in a situation which is very, very uncertain. Nobody could have predicted what is going to happen. And there, those who are from a liberal background, who can actually have an understanding of multiple disciplines, can connect the dot and understand nature, understand the impact of their decisions on the society, they are the ones who will be more required and more desirable in the futuristic context. So today, I think liberal art background, those who are coming from humanities, are the ones probably we are going to welcome in the profession as far as management profession is concerned.
Dr. Saxena, there is one more supplementary to this, and you can, I understand. So I'll you can add that answer once I finish this question. A lot of students ask us a question of whether, if they ultimately want to be a manager or a leader, should they do some other course at the bachelor's level and do an MBA at a postgrad level? Or should they do a BBA and an MBA because the curriculum is possibly similar is what the feeling is. So what would you advise a student who ultimately wants to be a manager or a leader, and what should he do at a undergrad level, and how he must take it at a postgrad level?
Well, Mahesh, in the first place, I think I see the students have shown that the undergraduate degree could be in any space, in any area. It doesn't make any difference. Because management education at the MBA level starts and is taught in an entirely different manner. You are talking about business, you are talking about decision making, you are talking about managing uncertainty. Now, here, let's say a degree in engineering or a degree in business at an undergraduate level for that matter, it doesn't really matter. What is significant, and this is where I just wanted to come in when Adish was mentioning, there are two things which are really missing today when we look at the students when they come in, and therefore the premium is then given to the students who can think in such kind of manner. One is in terms of the fact that many of the students who come in, you know, then they lack the power of building up a narrative. Now, you should look at most of the students who are coming up from an engineering program. This is where, you know, that problem rests in. Not because of the fact that they're expected to think in a linear fashion. And consequently, the non-linear functioning, of the mind, they're not able to do so. And as a consequence of which, the narrative suffers. The second part of it is the creativity, the creative part of it. And therefore, as long as these two skills we really talk about it, and these two things that we talk about it, then to that extent, it could even be tomorrow, let us say, an engineer who is able to do it. It could be even a science graduate who could do it. It could even be a fine arts student who can do it. A medical student can do it. Or it can be even the liberal arts student who can do it. Literature, history, philosophy, they can all come into it. And let me tell you that diversity in the class today is so important that all these different kinds of streams only add to making the discussion far more enriching and far more valuable. So from my point of view, it doesn't really make much of a difference.
But Atish, I throw the question back to you with a bit of a twist. At the end of it, you know, 10 years down the line, when someone is trying to pursue an undergrad today and 10 years down the line, would a BTech MBA be more valued or would a BBA MBA be more valued?
See, first of all, let us understand the MBA in the Indian context. Even if you look at the FT ranking, where our IIMs are ranked, you know, the ABCs, they are not in the MBA category. They are in the MIM category, which is essentially meant for freshers. MBA internationally is a JAL management program for experienced professionals. Now, why MBA has gained so much of popularity in India in its present form, okay, the way we call it MBA, is because the undergraduates have failed to deliver employability. That is number one. And number two, because those who have pursued engineering, they didn't want to pursue engineering in the first place. So immediately after that, 500 of them apply to a top school, and I have been in one, so I know that. So to my mind, if the undergraduate BBA program is strong, then there is no need to do an MBA program. For example, the way we are doing it at IFM Business School, we would do the BBA program in a manner that it eliminates the need to do an MBA. So if somebody wants to do an engineering and MBA, I think that's completely waste of time and money. It should be straight BBA, and as you said, 10 years, when the guy is going to become a JAL manager, when the JAL management skills are required, in that case, do a proper JAL management MBA, not an MIM type of an MBA. So to my mind, if the BBA is good, it eliminates the need for an MBA in the Indian context. And number two, if somebody wants to do an MBA post the graduation, it makes no sense. They should come to a good school and do a BBA. Like the kind of school that we are or NMIMS is.
Dr. Saxena, this is where I come back to the BBA part of it. I think you are in the top three or top four BBA schools in the country, right? Very few B schools offer BBA because you need to be a university. And you, I think, offer BBA and your BBA is very well accepted. How did you go about creating a curriculum which ensures that the student actually learns anything about business and management in a certain sense at the BBA level itself? And how, in terms of placement and in terms of everything, in terms of outcomes, how has it been for you?
Well, Mahesh, the BBA program curriculum at NMIMS, went through a multiple kind of processes. As we were redefining our kind of a position in the BBA back in 2010 and 2011 itself. And that's where we kept on doing it. And we have been doing it. The most important part was, where do we benchmark the BBA program? Do we benchmark it with the best in India, which was at that point of time, the BMS program at the Delhi University itself? Or should we really look at the BBA programs in the US? Quite clearly, it is the US that has really led a whole lot of our growth in BBA education, undergraduate education in management. So we went across, we went to the US and we started, and we were talking to a couple of schools. We identified some of the benchmark schools, and we looked at those schools as to what is it that they were doing and how were they really going about it. Three things emerged very clearly. One was, should the program be designed and without the industry input, that program will fail. And therefore we said, we need to create a board of studies which will have people from the industry primarily, and therefore I'm happy to report that today we have people from CRISIL. CRISIL's own managing director would be there, of that matter, let us say the executive director, the managing director of ICICI Bank would be there, or so the other firms who would be there, right, itself. Now, what has that meant? Well, that has meant that the programs today were in line with what the industry was looking for, particularly the financial services sector. And similarly, we brought people from the marketing area. Yeah. So the industry sat along with us to design the program. The third is the second part of it that we realized was that the cohort size has to be a bigger one. It cannot be small. It cannot be a boutique school if you really want to do something very different. So therefore we said, scale it up and scale with quality. So that was the second big thing. The third kind of a factor to my mind was that of, how do you make the school aspirational? That was a very important one. And if I look back at the journey of this school of mine, that the Anil Suresh Modi School of Commerce. The last 10 years, it has grown in aspirations, as you very rightly said. Many of the students would want to join it. The rankings show us as one of the best BBA programs. India Today ranks us number one, and some of the other magazines, Outlook Group itself has ranked us really high, everything else. I'm not talking about only from the point of view of the media, but now the question was that furthermore, the next part was that from an aspirational point of view, and therefore getting the best of the student from the India market, what is the next thing that we can do? Where are they getting this? So the careers became more important. It was not just the placement, but the careers. And for the careers, now we started building up the skills part of it. For example, analytics today is a big thing. And therefore, the skills in analytics itself. You also realize entrepreneurship is important. The entrepreneurship was there. But we continuously kept on building up the skills. Today is the day when the students get placed in companies like Nomura or some of the other well-known companies itself who visit us. And there are students who go and who get accepted at Wharton. They get accepted at London Business School. They get accepted anywhere else in the world. And they also join IIM Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Calcutta, etc. So those are the kind of things that are there.
Sir, but there's one more question that keeps coming back. There's a question from Dushyant. His question is, what is the difference between BBA and BMS?
It is interesting. The BMS is more of let's say, our own kind of a creation, the India creation, I call it as. It's like the MMS. MMS is the elder brother, and the younger brother is the BMS. The BBA, the strong focus itself and development of the skills that are required for the purposes of running the business and managing the business, I think that comes up in the BBA kind of. Okay. So therefore, the focus of the BBA program is primarily the business, the firm itself. We're looking at the unit from the firm point of view.
Okay, Atish, this is a question for you. I'm in 12th grade right now and I haven't taken maths. I wish to pursue business in future. What course is recommended for me, and which college would be the idea forget about the college. What course is recommended for him? Because this guy hasn't taken math. He's in class 12. He wants to, at some point in time, run his own business.
This is a misnomer that, you know, math is important. For example, those who are, you know, specializing in analytics in an MBA program, they may not be from a math background, because MBA does not say that you have to have a, you know, engineering or a math background. Now, the way we have, for example, looked at Vijayabhumi University is that in the first year of the curriculum, you do courses across each of the baskets. Like it will be science, it will be language, environmental sciences, performing arts, law, design, business. So one does course from across. So the point is, once you come to the program, you get an exposure to every other area. That is number one. Number two is, today we are talking about a 100-year life, which means there will be multiple careers. You may be in business, X business someday, tomorrow you may be in some other business. So what happens is, the holistic grooming becomes very important. Two important factors happen. One is this, that one must discover where we are good at. That discovery is important. Number two, as a personality, one should be a holistic personality. Third, whatever I do as a professional should create a social impact. So the answer to that question is, if the guy wants to do a business going forward, BBA, I would say, is a right program, which also allows the person an exposure across disciplines and allows a pathway based on which one can choose, this is where I want to focus my business on. So I will choose my courses in a combination. That is very, very important. You know, we have to move out of a straitjacketed approach to a more towards a discovery approach, exposure to multiple disciplines, and being a holistic professional who can create a social impact. I think BBA would be an ideal course.
A follow-up question on that, Atish. This is from a person called Verma. He wants to be an entrepreneur. So his question is, should he do an MBA in entrepreneurship or in analytics?
See, having been an entrepreneur myself, okay, because I was an entrepreneur out of college, okay. The question is this, that an MBA gives an overall exposure to business that is good enough to become an entrepreneur. If you look at most of the entrepreneurs, they are not even an MBA, okay. The point is, what is it that I would like to do? Which is the area which interests me? And that is the most important factor. What is my purpose? And based on my purpose, what are the courses that I should create? So a program which allows to create a mix and match of courses, a basket which is aligned to one's purpose, is something that he should do. And most of the new age universities, particularly like the ones where, you know, we have come up with, like Vijayabhumi, allows that to happen. I think the bespoke approach is very, very important, that I can create my own pathway depending upon my own interest. So it does not matter which particular specialization. Idea is, it should be a holistic approach.
Dr. Saxena, this is about international management or global management, as you say. The question has come from Samriddhi Singh. His question is, what are your opinions on BBA/MBA in international management or global management? Is it a viable option? Does it have good career prospects? Dr. Saxena?
Thank you very much. Yeah. I think this is a very valid kind of a question to my mind, because it really puts me into the thinking as to really what is the future of a program which is a global management program or anything.
Yeah, exactly. Especially in the post-COVID area, sir.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm talking about that. Also, if I look at, let us say, another factor, which is the technology. Internet-enabled kind of businesses today really do not require any kind of operations. They don't require a kind of field operations the way companies like Unilever or Brooke Bond or Glaxo have had in the past. These are companies like Amazon, for example, who may have a branch office, but the rest of it is really done online and chat. So my view is that yes and no, yes. To the extent that it helps you to understand the different cultures, it helps you to relate to those cultures, and also understand that how businesses are done in those countries. in multicultural environments. And so therefore, from that kind of a point of view, it's a good kind of an option. But the other part of it is, what if, let us say, the MBA program itself offers such a kind of an environment? Is it that the multicultural environment cannot be created in a regular MBA program? It's not necessarily attuned to any single part of it, global or domestic. But like I said, the Harvard itself, or for that matter, any of the top B schools in the world, they draw a whole lot of cohort from the world market. They have the faculty who teaches from diverse experience. They bring in the instructional material from different parts of the world. Really speaking, you are creating that kind of a multicultural environment for the students to learn. And so to that extent, an MBA from one of the top B schools, which has an international accreditation, and which also has a global reputation, is a great kind of a degree, and a portable degree, if I were to say that. You can port it anywhere. Okay. You can go anywhere. Navigate the world market with that. That's what I look at.
I would like to just add one point here, okay? Now, one is that when we are looking at a global management program, if the candidate or the student is aspiring to work in an international location, then there are those pathway programs. For example, IFM Business School has got programs which in collaboration with State University of New York, in collaboration with Sydney Business School in University of Wollongong. So after the first year, the second year is spent in Sunny or in UW in Australia, which means a student can opt for a career in Australia or US. Two things become important is that the accreditation. So an AACSB accreditation, like an international accreditation, is a big help from the student's perspective. And number two, the whole fact is that today's situation, as you said, probably instead of going only for a international degree, it is good to to get into a program where you get a degree both from India as well as from abroad, which means you have got both the options open, whether you want to work in an international location or in India. I think that's the way forward.
I quite agree, Mahesh. I think today the time when one has to consider the dual degree kind of programs, particularly the ones that allow people to really have a part of India and the rest of the world kind of or study anywhere else in the world also. For example, as I said, that if the schools that are partnering are some of the top schools of the kind that I think you're just mentioning, then it certainly is. NMIMS, for example, you're aware, about a year and a half back, we decided to partner with or enter into a partnership with Purdue University. And we offer today a dual degree program, which is in the area of decision sciences. MBA Decision Science and Business Analytics and Intelligence itself. Now, here, the first one year is really at NMIMS. The next two semesters are at Purdue, and after that, the internship followed straight away towards a corporate job itself, anywhere in the world itself. So this is something which I think is really the future.
I think I'll summarize what Dr. Saxena just said, because sir, your voice is echoing, so I'm just repeating because students are talking about that. What Dr. Saxena says is that this is the time for the students to start considering dual degree programs, because you de-risk yourself, because you have an Indian degree and possibly an international degree also. And the learning is happening both in India and outside of India. So his suggestion is that this is the time possibly that students must start exploring the dual degree programs more seriously than what it was earlier.
Exactly. That's the opportunity that the accredited institutions offer. Like, you can go for a career on either side.
I understand. So there is one question that keeps coming back, sir, to us. Should students prefer integrated MBA, or should they do a graduation program, undergrad program, and then build up a work ex of 3-4 years and then get onto an MBA?
Well, Mahesh, our experience today has shown that both these options are really preferred. integrated program, for example, the kind that we have really created as an example, like in the area of technology management, MBA Tech, today is perhaps one of the most preferred options in the area of technology itself, technology engineering itself. We get quickly subscribed to the MBA Tech, and later the engineering and some other disciplines really come into it. Likewise, at the same time, we have an MBA, an integrated program in the area of entrepreneurship and family business and management and family business management, which again is a very much preferred kind of a program. That's a 5-year kind of a program. This is coming from all those who are wanting to make a career to be an entrepreneur, or those who come in from the family businesses and want to really get groomed up for taking up the senior positions back in their own family businesses. But at the same time, we also realized that there are options straight away. BBA itself is very important, very, very interesting. And alongside with the BBA, I think this is also a new development center taking place. There are different streams in which BBA is really getting developed. And an example, I mean, I can go back to NMIMS, because last year we did enter into a partnership with, we created a school for advertising and communication management, in partnership with Pralhad Karkar, the well-known advertising. We created a Pralhad Karkar School of Business and Advertising. We created a BBA program in branding and advertising. And we are also going to be offering a BA honors in filmmaking, in multimedia. That's an area. Another one is in BBA hospitality. What I'm saying that multiple now streams are now opening up, and therefore the students are best advised to look at where their talent really lies, what is their aptitude, rather than just making money for just one simple straightforward vanilla BBA.
Okay. So essentially what Dr. Saxena says is that you need to first of all understand your interest levels before getting on to whether BBA or MBA or integrated MBA. And that's something, for example, the course that the Narasimhanji offers along with analytics as an integrated program is a very good program, which is very well sought after. And when you have that kind of an admission with you, then it is far better that you do the integrated program. But otherwise, if you're trying to do integrated for the heck of integrated, it might not be worth it. It's very important to understand your interest and match it with the kind of course that has some kind of a pedagogy and some kind of a legacy and some kind of an outcome which is proven, and that works for them. Atish, my question is to you now. In terms of BBA, you know, students are being asked too early in their life to decide what they want to be. And, you know, within BBA also, I've realized, 15 days back, I saw one university which is offering 15 specializations within BBA. Right. So now, what do you look at it? You know, are we telling the student far too early of asking them what they want to be and basically, shackling them and chaining them and saying, this is what you must do kind of a thing? Don't they have the freedom to decide at some point in time, slightly later in their life than right away?
See, that is what we are trying to do at Vijay Bhumi University, for example, to unshackle that. So one gets in, takes courses across baskets, across disciplines, find out the interest area, and after 2 years of the graduation, only then you decide which is the area where I want to do my major, which means that the option is open for the student. This is a discovery process, post which you decide, okay, I am good in design communication, I will go for design communication. I can make a combination of data sciences and business. I can make a combination of law and business. So the advantage is with the student to first understand and discover each of the areas, go through courses across disciplines, then decide where I am good at and where I would like to major or what kind of combination that I want to make. I am not in favor of straitjacketing at all. The option should be all the while with the students to find out what they are good at and then create a combination based on one's purpose and based on one's interest. That's what one should be looking at. And that's what we offer.
So, which is right, but still everyone still offers those specializations, right? So when a student is getting an admission in a university or a B school and is getting a BBA admission and is given 6 options of one of them to be chosen, so he doesn't have an option but to choose one of them, right? not everyone says, okay, you are doing BPA and you will major at something else. They actually have six kinds of courses. So how does a student go about deciding what to do then?
See, the question is, there are two options of entry. One is declared major and another is undeclared major. See, somebody who wants to really explore, discover and make the choice should get into an undeclared major. So after the period of say 1.5 years, 2 years and going through the whole courses, then only you decide what I would like to major in. The universities also should give that flexibility that after if somebody after 1.5 years, which is around 20 years of age, decides that I want to make a shift, I think that the shift should be allowed and new age universities allow that shift to happen and allow that process of discovery and to choose the major after a certain period of time. I think that is the key. We need to unshackle education and not shackle.
Dr. Saxena, this is a question that off late, because of computer sciences being a very predominant job creator, has come. What are the courses in a management institution, either at an undergrad or a postgrad, which has greater scope for people who want to be analysts or data analysts or are specializing in data sciences? What are the specializations that you have?
One is obviously, as I just mentioned, this is a dual degree program with the Purdue, which has MBA Decision Science and Business Intelligence and Analytics Management, which we are doing. In addition to that, we also offer courses in the area of data sciences itself, BTech, BTech, and at the BSc level itself, and also at the MTech and at an MSc level itself. And in addition to that, invariably, in almost all our undergraduate programs, we have brought in analytics as the major inputs, as one of the required input itself. But we do realize that analytics data is important. It's a world of data. And it isn't just very important to know the tools. So therefore, we said that we focus on the tools, first learn the tools. The second part of it is how do you use it? The application then now has become far more important. So when we were designing, for example, the BTech data science or the BSc data science, the applied the statistics and data sciences itself, I mean, our focus was on really looking at the application part rather than just merely only talking about the tools part. And in the MBA level, our focus was completely towards the decision making itself. So we realized that the criticality today is that of the decision. So how do you make a decision? That somehow or the other gets lost out. Because today the machine is really doing out the entire analytics itself. But what is really missing out is the decision part of it. There are a range of programs that we are offering, that the universities are today offering also. At the BSc level, at the BTech level, and at the management level.
But Dr. Saxena, if you were to be asked to choose in terms of pecking order of the likely demand for such specialists, such management specialists in terms of marketing, which includes digital marketing, finance, HR, analytics, and so on and so forth, do you have a pecking order of what is in greater demand from the employer perspective?
I think to my mind, in the first place, the conventional roles have changed. The way we have looked at the jobs, for example, the product manager, for example, in marketing, or for that matter, let us say a financial analyst kind of also, the way we have looked at the financial analyst, because a lot of work is being done by the machine. So there are new job roles that are today emerging, which is basically, I would say, a kind of a combination of the functional knowledge and also the analytics itself. So from that kind of point of view, if I were to look at the kind of job opportunities that have come up, the job opportunities at the undergraduate level is also at the postgraduate level. Typically in the area of analytics, finance, general management, HR, marketing. These are obviously marketing is really one of those kind of a more preferred option along with the finance and analytics. These are the three big options, big kind of groups. At the buckets in which the students generally specialize.
So essentially what you're saying is analytics, finance, general management,
marketing,
and then HR.
Yeah.
Yeah. and HR. Yeah, yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Atish, this is a question for you. This person is, you know, passing out. This is from a person called Pulkit Saxena. Atish, this is for you. The question is whether after graduation, the person should directly join MBA or should she have a build in a work experience onto an MBA?
See, as I said, if somebody wants to do a real general management program, then the work experience becomes important. And in that case, MBA post experience. Okay. Now, let me give you a very simple situation. Somebody who is an engineer has invested 4 years. Okay. I would probably say, if you are getting a good, what I call, position where you are interested in, then do work, and after 5-6 years, consider doing a general management program or an MBA. But if you are not into a, you know, what I call, getting a good kind of a job opportunity, in that case, MBA becomes the only option. But that is where I think a good undergraduate program helps. That's what my take is.
Okay, this is a question that's come 3 times by now. I'm reading it. And the last question has come from Salam Singh. I don't take maths in 10 plus 2, but I prefer BBA finance. How much, you know, so essentially this person is not a math student. And a lot of questions, by the way, are saying that we don't have maths in our undergrad plus 2, but they still want to do a BBA. What is the kind of course within BBA that they must do and then go about their career path?
See, first of all, that relationship between maths and finance and maths and data science, I think that myth needs to be broken. Jack Ma is an English graduate. Okay. Now, after somebody comes in, I think in a business program, the way the courses are delivered, it makes sure that somebody who is not in a maths background is also equally comfortable in doing the finance courses. I think that's something which becomes important. Even data science can be pursued by people who are not with a maths background. That is what the take is.
Now, Dr. Saxena, in the post-COVID world that we're about to live in, how would be the placement scenario for the batch of 2020 and 2021 and later also? Because there seems to be some kind of a shakeup that seems to be happening. What is your broader take on this subject?
Well, I think it's a little too early to really think about that. One thing is for sure that the joining of the MBA graduates this year, those who had received the offers, let's say at an MIMS, for example, almost the entire batch getting placed, both in the MBA HR and that the joining is likely to get affected.
You're breaking, sir. So you're breaking.
There's expected to be getting delayed. There's no doubt about it.
Okay.
But perhaps in the future, what I'm really looking at is that more and more jobs would be those that would be centric. It will help people to really work on their own, independently, autonomously, and also work in a collaborative manner. So autonomous functioning and collaborative functioning will become now important. So for example, somebody who's, let's say, a market specialist or market development specialist. In the conventional way, he would have gone to the office, he would have spent a lot of time in the markets, etc. Today, a lot of things that he could possibly do it from home, he could possibly do it whatever in the country from home, put up the reports, and possibly then take the next step of making a presentation to the boards itself. So I would imagine that greater degree of autonomous and collaborative functioning will be important. But far more important to my mind is that the jobs and the industry would be requiring people who can manage uncertainty in a very big
way. So you're breaking. I'm pausing, you know. You're breaking, so I'm pausing, you know, sir. You're breaking. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll come back to you, sir, because you're breaking as of now. Atish, this is a question that is asked by many people, which is that should a student try to do an executive MBA after putting in 4-5 years of work X, or should he do an MBA after 3 years work X? Because so for executive MBA, PGPX or something, it requires a 5-year kind of a thing because you learn more. So what is the pathway that you would suggest for a student who wants to do an MBA? Executive MBA or a normal MBA?
See, again, it depends. Again, if you look at an MBA, it is essentially a track change program. So number one, there are two types of people who do an MBA in India. One is those who have been into a particular stream like engineering, but they didn't like to be an engineer, want to come to do an MBA to become a consultant or an investment banker and so on and so forth. That is number one. Number two, those who come to do an MBA are the ones who have not got a job of their satisfaction post, you know, their graduation. So these are the two people who will go and do an MBA immediately post the graduation because they didn't like the stream or didn't get the job. Now, I think there is going to be a big change which is going to happen. Today, if somebody is a good graduate, okay, would probably earn 8 or 10 lakh rupees per annum straight out of college. Now, if the guy decides to do an MBA after 2 years, the opportunity cost is around 20 lakhs of giving away the salary and another 25 lakhs of doing an MBA. The cost of the MBA becomes 45 lakhs. And in India, US already this phenomenon has happened, so the MBA programs have taken a dip. In India, I would also expect a similar thing to happen. So what will happen is, A, those who are not getting a good job after graduation, they will be doing an MBA. Those who are in the job, in the profession where they want to continue and don't do a track change, would actually go for an online program, okay, where, or a program where they don't need to leave the job, which means I continue to be in the job and do a program where I learn management and I learn the jail management scheme. I think that is the way forward, the way I look at it.
And what is your take on distance learning MBA, Atish? Because there are quite a few institutions now offering distance learning MBA.
See, there is a difference between the way distance learning is defined is going to be also be very different, particularly post-COVID. I think distance learning necessarily nowadays means that the courseware is there and I just access the courseware based on my own convenience. First, if you change the word distance learning to remote synchronized learning, which means you conduct the class just like the way you conduct a class in the classroom, and I do a program where I can access the classroom sitting at my own convenient place at my own time. That means that what happens is that I do get an almost classroom-like experience where I'm interacting directly with the faculty. And also I can interact with my peers in small groups. So I think the shift will be from distance learning to synchronized online learning. And post-COVID, that is what is going to gain popularity.
Dr. Saxena, this is for you. This is from a person called Rashi Sadwani. The question is, every B school claims 100% placement. Are the claims true, or how does one read those claims?
I think, I think the best way to really know whether the what is being claimed is right or not is to go on the public platform and take a look at what is really being reported. But I don't think any of the top B schools or any institution would like to really. That's a very big risk. If let's say today an institution like NMIMS goes to report the wrong data. Now, all our data today is on the NIRF portal. It's there on the AIBDE portal. It's there on let's say in various other kind of portals itself, you know, on your report, kind of media itself. So I think important thing is to look at what is being reported and whether it is being reported in a public kind of a media itself. Because that's where the responsibility lies of the institution, to be honest. There is no other way that one can really think about it. There is one kind of a way which is being tried out, experimented by some of the other actors. It is done by getting an audit by EY or honorary audit by Crucible or by any of them or by any of these specialized agencies, etc. That has its own limitation because I had the presentation from some of them. I think the entire methodology still needs to be perfected in terms of looking at the whole audit process itself. But one thing is for sure, that the information that comes in, and the appointment letters, etc., in most cases come very late. Operators come in very late. And by the time the graduate students are graduating itself, but you receive a lot of communications from the company which is bringing you that kind of a offer itself, that gives the details itself. There's a lot of things that still need to be perfected, but I guess over a period of time, the way forward would be in terms of maybe the audit also.
So I'll also add to what Dr. Saxena said just now, Rashi. Increasingly, the data of placements of many of these institutions is transparently available if you care to search for it properly. I'll tell you the first thing that they are supposed to do is mandatory disclosure, which means that they essentially have to put up all the data that they have on their own website. Many people don't do it. Don't worry about that, because people like us do fight to ensure that it's available there. Two, in NIRF ranking, they again are supposed to submit all this data. Three, there is something called SSR, which they submit to the UGC and all, where again all this data available. The fourth one is now all the universities are supposed to submit every single data point in terms of the intake, the placement, the salary and everything to AICT. All these four are captured by people like us. At careers360.com, today I'm proud to say that for about 11,000 institutions, across courses, course-wise, we actually have data of what the intake is and what the placement has been. And the more we look at that, we realize that, for example, today I can very clearly say that in IIT Delhi also, a civil engineering student, 40% are not placed. So the thing that when you get into IIT Delhi, your future is set is not true, because if you don't get the right courses, you're not likely to be placed. So I think it's very important for you to start looking at data. And two, I would also add a bit in terms of the choosing the branch within an institution. The flagship branch is always the more preferred branch. Then you actually have this, like when you have 10 specializations, you must be very, very careful about it. It means that it is possibly expanding the net and nothing more. And I'm talking possibly as an activist at this point in time. But so the thing is that if there's a flagship course that you're taking, be sure that it is the best course that it has, because the institution has been built up on the flagship course. But after that, you need to be very cautious in terms of looking at the data to see whether the placement actually happened. The placement hasn't happened, it's far better that you go to another B school and pitch on to the flagship course there, then get onto the 10th course of a B school, which is very good, but it's not placing.
Yeah, I quite agree with you. I think it's at the end of the day, it is the school quality and the top schools today in the country have a lot to protect in terms of their reputation. I don't think anybody would like to risk that.
Said a lot of people are asking about, the question obviously is about college fees and affordability. I'm just rephrasing the questions, because I see a lot of questions about the BBA and MBA being very expensive or it's not affordable and so on and so forth. What do institutions like yourself do to ensure that the meritorious students still walk into your college and study with you in terms of your scholarships, your fee waivers, deferments, loans? What are you?
There are three things that we really do. And I think typically anybody would be doing that. One is in terms of the fee concessions that we offer, strictly on the basis of the merit itself. And if the merit is established, then in that case, that merit is in the form of, let's say, your fast track record, and then also, let's say, the NMAT score or your NPAT score or any of those kinds of scores. Then in that case, we offer them. Second is let's say you really have a very significant kind of a means problem. You were not able to afford it, but you're a good student otherwise. Then such cases are really taken up by the management. And on a case-by-case basis, we take a decision on whether to really offer any assistance or not. So that's one. Secondly, in terms of the scholarship. At NMIMS, we have a couple of scholarships. One is in terms of Chancellor's scholarship. The Chancellor's scholarship has been created by the endowment that the trust has been created. and it has been contributed to by the alumni association also. So about this year, for example, about 8 to 10 students may be able to get that kind of a scholarship. Depends on the kitty that is available to the side of the kitty at a given point of time, which is there. Third is in terms of the loans, the access to financial institutions. We have some specialized, we have some relationships with some of the banks. So we really offer them those kind of access to those banks with whom we. Once the student is admitted by us, they know that, well, obviously, this is a good student that comes through a kind of a highly transparent admission process and will have a safe future. So that is one part. And the last part of it is that we also, there's some of them who come from the reserve categories or some of those kind of marginalized kind of groups. The government also has some scholarships that are available. So we give the data to the government, and wherever such kind of cases are there, and if there are there, these are very few in number, but primarily I would say fee concessions, scholarships from the chancellors. And the third is in terms of the loans that are there. And the fourth is alumni association on its own going forward and looking at individual cases or step by step. For example, one of the students lost his father in the second year, and he don't have any way by which he would have completed in the MBA program. So some of our alumni really came forward.
Okay.
Because that very student is working in HSBC in London, working in London, and a fair year, and then just moved up the ladder. Now he said, he kind of came back to the Alumni Association, said, I want to now give back to the institution, to the association.
Atish, this is another question for you, and this is a confusion that students have. What can you explain to the students the difference between PGPM? PGDM and MBA?
I think all those institutions which are part of the university system offers an MBA. All those who are standalone institutions which are under the aegis of AICTE gives the PGDM. Okay. And lot of institutions who actually give a PGDM call their degree PGPM because conventionally the MBA program is known as the PGP program. I think that's the fundamentally, those who are offering PGDM also are actually equivalent to an MBA. But one thing which is going to happen, because now IIMs are offering an MBA and earlier they used to offer a PGDM, I think going forward, MBAs will be becoming more popular. That's my take.
So if a student were to be given an option of an MBA and a PGDM, how does he choose? Does he have to consider the weight of a PGDM versus MBA to choose between the two?
Mahesh, let me just respond, and then Atish can also add to that.
He has a
pretty rich experience in terms of the PGDM itself. One, as he very rightly said, that one of the important things is that this is just a nomenclature kind of a difference. Really speaking, there is no difference between the PGDM and the MBA. What makes the difference between the PGDM and the MBA program, if at all, is It is the curriculum. It's the program design. I think how well that program has been structured and how well that has been designed and how it is being executed and what is the link that the program has built to the institution itself. Now, there are PGDM institutions like MDI, as an example, which have been doing an extremely good job in terms of their offers itself. There have been Great Lakes that has been offering the same kind of thing. Or let's say ISB, which has had no kind of a formal recognition, yet it has offered one of the most, I would say, aspirational program in the country itself and in the world itself. So I think what is important is the design of the program, the execution, the pedagogy that you are using, the partnerships that you build in it. And the third is in terms of the placement. What kind of placements are you working on? And clearly, if the cohort is good, And the institution has the right kind of accreditation and the structure is right, it'll also draw in some good faculty. So typically a combination is that the input-output relationship is very strong in the context of a good management school, irrespective of the nomenclature of it.
Okay. This is a question from Jatin Dube. His question is it worth spending 10 to 15 lakhs for BBA, or should I go for a low college, low fee college, and invest that amount in my MBA?
Oh, that's the, you know, it's a 3 years that somebody is what we call investing, and I think it is very important that, you know, a good value program is taken up, and I think those who are probably, you know, one can find very competitively priced programs also. For example, you were just talking about merit scholarship. For example, our BBA program at Vijayabhumi is, you know, less than 10 lakhs in terms of tuition fee. And for in-state, which we have got two types of fees, in-state and out-of-state. So domicile Maharashtra students, it is less than 7.5 lakhs. And then there are scholarships. So I think it is good to invest in a good BBA program and go straight into the job market rather than wasting 3 years and then go for an MBA program and then do another 2 years, which is complete uncertainty. I would always invest in good education. That's my take.
It's a ladder. If you were to look at it, think of this as a kind of an education ladder. And I think you consider this as an education ladder. Now, you should really understand that at the bottom is really your school education. So if you have really got, you should come out of a good school that has helped you to really acquire some good education and has developed you as a good student, then it is time for you to really look at which is the school which is the institution that is going to help you to take it forward itself. A strong ladder, or which is linked to the industry, is far more important than any ladder.
Okay.
So I believe that a good quality MBA or a BBA program coming from the top, from any of the best, better known schools itself, and the MBA program, if you want to look at it as a ladder, one step or the other, believe me, you are building up a career. This is not just maybe 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, but it's a
lifetime.
I think we've completely run out of our time, but Atish, can you give the last bit of advice to the students, you and Dr. Saxena separately, of what would you advise a student at an undergrad level as far as management is concerned?
I think that, you know, choose a program which allows to discover what you are good at, discover one's purpose, and allows an approach where they can mix and match and try a lot of things, because that is the period where one should discover and try and then find out what they are good at and finally gets what, you know, the kind of employment that they are looking at, whether as an entrepreneur or as a professional. And I think those options are there. Good schools like Vijayabhumi University or what we call Dr. Saxena's Narsimhanji, they offer such opportunities. So a good BBA program is a good investment in building one's career. I think that's what one should look at.
Dr. Saxena?
Mahesh, I'll go a little more in terms of a general person. What should be a good undergraduate degree program look like?
Exactly.
That is the important thing. Commerce, a couple of things that it must do. Number one, and the first and the most important thing is the social skills. Providing the student opportunity to develop their social skills. Because when you start looking at the society, the most critical kind of a skill is the social skills.
Yeah.
How do you relate to the people itself? That is important. And therefore, a good kind of an institution and a good undergraduate degree, whole lot of the student activities. There. A lot of exploration that the student activities allows you to do that. You learn the art of planning, you learn the art of decision making, you learn the art of team building, team management, you learn the art of managing the most uncertain environment, we learn the art of managing the constraints itself. That's some of the very important kind of skills that an undergraduate gives. Second, the very important kind of skills are leadership skills. A good undergraduate degree must really develop your own your leadership skills. I remember my days at Delhi University as an undergraduate student. I think I enjoyed it in the hilt at the Shriram College in Delhi because of the fact that these were some of the things that I was able to do it. And the third part of it is, as I said, in today's time, a degree that allows you to experiment, that allows you to not really say, have a tunneled view of a situation, but you can look at it from a 360-degree view of a situation itself, and therefore give you the exposure, or therefore give you the opportunity to learn from different disciplines itself, as was said very rightly by Atish. Picking up the courses from different disciplines helps you to do that. And the last part of the undergraduate degree is it must help you to understand what it means to be a responsible citizen, which means taking care of your environment, getting the right set of values, which is extremely difficult to be developed when you come to the two-year postgraduate program, be it in commerce, business, or technology. A whole lot of our character building happens here, and the development of the personality really happens over there.
Thank you, Dr. Saxena. I think that was brilliant. The summing up was brilliant. Thank you, and I hope that I'll keep bothering you once in a while to ensure that some students benefit or most students benefit from our advice.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.